uniting communities throughout the six. This is Urban Definition with your hosts Sassan, Kareem, and Zayn on CHHA 1610.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Urban Definition. My name is Zayn, and I'm joined by my co-hosts Kareem.
What up, what up, what up?
And Sassan.
Hey, guys.
Oh, my goodness. I got a pair of new headphones, and they are magnificent.
Well, I'm glad you like them.
I can hear you guys breathing.
Really?
That's really creepy. Please. Oh, my God.
It's the way he says it, and then he has his hair slicked back like that.
Oh, I won't even lie. I had my cap on all day, so I probably look like Norman Bates.
You do. See? Yeah.
Yeah.
Totally. Yeah. It's really creepy. Please don't kill us.
Wow. What can I say? Psycho! Talk about psycho.
Oh, boy. Well, that was a terrible way to segment into that one.
Nah. What's going on in the world today, guys?
Well, today, everything's been dominated in the news recently by the tragic Orlando shootings.
That's absolutely true.
And it's a very sad event because it does mark the largest mass shooting in United States history, which no doubt before that Virginia Tech.
Wait, are you talking about the largest mass shooting in
U.S. history?
U.S. history?
Yeah.
Was it Virginia Tech?
I think it was, yeah.
Okay, well, that's what I think they're saying, but it's not true, actually. In 1863 or 1853, over 300 black people were killed at polling stations over the right to vote.
By a mass shooting?
Yeah.
I didn't know that. Well, then in the last 50 years, I think that's what the report
is. No. I mean, they're probably saying this is... I've seen it where they're saying, oh, this is the largest in U.S. history. But...
I guess that's factually incorrect.
It's one of those things that they kind of... I think they kind of take it out of the history books. They don't really report on things like that, right?
Definitely. And this event really has a lot of implications on us across North America, at least.
Across all borders.
Definitely, because it was very unprecedented in the sense of, like, the target was a gay nightclub in Miami. Or, sorry, in Orlando. Why did I say Miami? Completely wrong. A lot of people were first painting this. Is this a hate crime? Is this a terror attack? What is this? Is this just a shooting? And I think it's kind of a combination of all three, almost, because you have a shooter who allegedly called 911 before the attack to pledge his allegiance to a terrorist organization. He targeted a gay nightclub, which is a very specific place, and it was a very large shooting, and he was afterwards, as interviews have told us, that he was mentally unstable. And it's kind of like all three of the biggest things in news kind of came together in this story, and it's a very interesting angle that this is that now.
Yeah, I agree with you. Sassan, what's your take before I go off on my rant?
Well, didn't his parents say that he wasn't really a Muslim to begin with? Like, this wasn't because of that kind of stuff? Because I remember you told me that it had something to do with him just watching lots of internet videos, and that's what caused this. He wasn't affiliated with ISIS at all, and this is just him being crazy.
All right, so for me, my whole thing is when the police did the research on him, yes, I did say he's not a member of ISIS. He watched a lot of ISIS radical videos, but he was not a member of ISIS. And if you guys remember a couple of weeks ago, maybe even last week, because I do this a lot, I talk about the influence of media. And for me, this is just another example of the media perpetuating fears. And I wouldn't necessarily use the word stereotypes in this situation, but instilling fear and using scare tactics. And the very first thing that they went towards was Islam, because so many people, especially in the United States, suffer from Islamophobia, which obviously is a fear of Muslims.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you're right. The parents said he was not a Muslim. And this really and truly just boils down to mental health, where, you know, he had a hatred. I heard stories, I'm not sure the validity of, oh, you know, he saw two guys kissing when he was younger and was disgusted, and whatever the case may be, whatever his beliefs might be, it all comes down, and at the end of the day, it all boils down to his mental health, which was not stable, which was not right. He wasn't all there. You can't do something like this and be there.
No, you definitely cannot. It's definitely a mental illness that he had to have suffered to do this kind of thing. But then there's reports of he was secretly gay. He was a closeted homosexual, which, I mean, there's so many things that are coming out, which is like, what's true and what's not true.
For things like that, like little, I wouldn't call it, points like that where, oh, you know, he was a homosexual and he saw two guys kissing when he was younger and was, none of those things really matter to me. He's a human being who did a very sick and disgusting and disturbing thing. And now, yes, we're going to talk about it. And the onus kind of falls on us. And when I say us, I'm talking about the global community in terms of Canadians, Americans, Australians, Africans, everywhere. You need to educate people. We need to talk about mental health. We need to talk about, you know, what really happened. Because, I mean, my little brother, I'm sure, is asking right now, you know, you see it all over the news. Why did one man kill another man or kill many people? Because why did he kill you? Because you liked a guy. Do you understand what I mean?
Yeah, definitely. And it's even broader than that then, because then it gets into a whole bunch of other issues. Gun control in the U.S., Islamophobia, homophobia. We had the whole issue of transgender bathrooms just a few weeks ago.
Yeah.
Things like that, where it's like everything, that's what I'm saying. This kind of all culminates together, and it's very terrifying, because it's like, where have we come into human history?
Terrifying is a good word. I definitely think you hit the nail on the head with that one, because at the end of the day, it's like all these things have just been occurring over the last few weeks, culminating in this massive, tragic incident. And it's just like, how did we go from last week mourning the death of Muhammad Ali and feeling that a man should not be in a woman's bathroom, and people going crazy on social media about, you know, oh my gosh, they shouldn't be doing this, and I'm scared of this guy being in a washroom with my girl, and I don't like transgendered people, and I'm scared of gay people, to now it's completely flipped. This week, we are on the sides. We're you know, showing our respect towards the gay and
LGBTQ.
Okay. Community, and now we're fearful of Muslims again. Like, I don't understand what kind of world are we living in right now?
Well, that's what I'm saying. This has impacted us on so many different levels. And just to mention, there was a Canadian hostage who was killed by a terrorist group in the Philippines called Abu Sayyaf. Canadian Robert Hall, he was killed by the group because they wanted ransom. And Prime Minister Trudeau said, no, we're not going to pay ransom.
Yeah, we're not paying ransoms to...
We have to find other ways. And I was reading another report, the family agreed with him, and it's just kind of all of this coming all at once, you know. It's just so much to take in. So it's like, you know, there really needs to be a call for change somewhere. In education, in acceptance, in...
Well, it definitely does fall on the onus of social institutions. By social institutions, I'm referring to the police. I'm referring to schools, the education system.
But you know what the problem then becomes is, like, also political figures. Because then you have responses from people like Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton and the president, and, you know, they're all saying what they want to say and, you know, their relation to it. But, you know, depending on who you believe and how your thought process is, things get lost in translation between messages and stuff, right?
Yeah, I understand. I mean, 100%.
And I hate talking about it, but Donald Trump, for example, his whole thing where he tweets, called it, you should be, you know, I appreciate your congratulations, but I don't want it, or something, where it's like, what are you talking about? Because he basically saying, like, you know, I saw this coming, this was going to definitely happen and stuff. And, you know, instead of acknowledging what the real problem is, he goes, you know, this is why we need to ban Muslims from the United States. And it's like, that's not the issue. The issue was gun control, mental instability, everything like that. As well as you were saying, the influence of media and, like, you know, having proper education stop these kind of things.
I think
so you have
me,
that, and then if you have followers of his, they're going to buy it up. They're going to believe it. Then you have people on social media saying a whole bunch of crazy things, and I'm sure people have tweeted, "I'm glad this happened. This is they deserved it." You know, people who are ultra conservative or completely homophobic would have been like, "Good," and people who are, you know, I would like to say, in our thought process, they realize that this is actually a tragedy and it's horrible.
Yeah. So for me, it's at the end of the day, you're always going to have jackals online. When you have a platform as big as, well, I'm calling social media a platform, but really and truly it's multiple platforms. But when you do have something as massive as social media, you're bound to have jackals. And America was built on the whole concept that it didn't matter what you believed in, you still had the right to be able to express yourself and be able to at least say what you believed, even if 90% of the population is not going to actually agree with you. You still have the right and freedom, you have liberal freedom to be able to express yourself as you please, as long as you weren't endangering the health and safety of other people.
And that's exactly what this did. It endangered the health and safety of multiple people.
No. I think you're kind of losing me here. I'm talking about somebody going online and being able to say, you know, I don't like you or yada yada XYZ. You still have the right to do it. That's an American right and an American freedom. What do you think?
Okay, I see what you're saying there. It's when does that right become a license to do that? And my cousin actually pointed this out to me. He was saying, you know, just because you have the liberty, does it become a license to do these kinds of things where you have to think about where your actions hurt others, right? Larger than just yourself. And I thought that was a pretty profound thing, actually, because it gave me a new perspective of, like, the limits on freedom. And that's the whole, there's so many debates that we have, right, with transgender bathrooms, gun control, this and that. At what point does your liberty and your rights and freedoms infringe on others? So that's my whole take on it. And I think
it's a tricky situation. And unfortunately, it's one of those topics where there never is, you know, a cut and dry answer. It's one of those things where people are going to have different opinions. People are going to have to say, but it's hard. It's one of those things that there's no answer.
Definitely. And actually, we'll have a guest later on after the commercial break coming up in a minute who has a very unique perspective about this topic, and we'll definitely talk to him about it as well. But yeah, no, you're right. It's a conversation that needs to be had, and I think it's just a very tragic thing, man.
Something that I do want to mention before we go to commercial break that is, you know, I see it as a step in the right direction is the pro-Islamic billboards that are going up across Toronto and Canada right now, where they're instilling, you know, there's no need to fear Muslims, and, you know, have you seen those yet?
I haven't actually seen many.
It's basically a picture of a young lady with a hijab on and a gentleman, a white Caucasian gentleman, and they're basically face-to-face, they're smiling, and it's basically a billboard to say, you know, like, you don't have to fear Muslims.
No, there definitely shouldn't have to be any Islamophobia in this city, in this country. Mm-hmm. You know, that's one of the great things is I was just in New York this weekend and realizing the differences between Canada and the United States. I'm so glad I can call this place home. For those of you listening right now, let us know your thoughts on social media. Hit up urbandefinition.ca, go on our Facebook and Twitter pages, and use the hashtag urbandefinition, and let us know what your thoughts. We'll be right back.
This is Urban Definition. Urban Definition. On CHHA 1610.
Welcome back to Urban Definition. Just before the break, we were talking about the Orlando shootings. And Zayn, you said that there's a special caller on the air.
What? Yeah. So tonight, our guest is Dr. Izzy Hirji, DVM. He's a veterinary doctor who is an active member of the local community and is also an openly gay Muslim who has been activist for queer rights for the last decade. He is an active member of Ismaili Queers, a support network with a number of over 150 individuals across the globe who have taken part in many pride parades, most notably in Toronto for the last 5 years. So without further ado.
It's a pleasure to have you. Doctor, are you there?
Thanks, guys. Yeah, thanks for having me on the show.
Perfect. We're honored to have you on air.
Honored to be here.
So Izzy, welcome to Dr. Hirji, I should say, because I've known him for a little bit now, so it's going to take some while to get used to. Dr. Hirji, thank you for joining us. Tell us your first reaction when you heard about the shooting.
I guess, yeah, it was when I woke up on Sunday morning, and that was the first thing I read on the internet there, and I just started watching some videos to get a clearer idea of what happened. I mean, my first reaction was just breaking down in tears. Like, I didn't even know what to think. I was in shock, really. You know, the fact that another mass shooting happened in the U.S. is ridiculous in and of itself, because I think there have been like 16 in the last like year and a half or something like that. But then when I, you know, learned more details of where it happened and, you know, how many victims there were and the fact that they were still unidentified at that time. And I mean, this is a place that I've considered going to when I was in Florida to, you know, go out and have a night of fun. And, you know, the people that were victims were people just like me and my friends. And it's just one of those things that you never expect to happen. And it was just extremely close to home for me. And I mean, the other thing that went through my mind is a lot of these people probably weren't even out to their families or friends or whatever, and now their families and friends are being called on to identify either their dead bodies or like going to the hospital to, you know, see the wounded individuals. And it was just like, you know, there were so many things going on and so many layers to the situation that were just incomprehensible at the time.
I couldn't have said that better myself. That's so true. I think one of the craziest thoughts is the fact that, from what I was told, even days after the tragedy, there were still dead bodies in the club, and the police and whoever else were going inside had to deal with the fact that people's cell phones were still ringing from loved ones trying to reach them.
Wow.
That's heartbreaking.
That is, imagine being an officer in that situation and kind of walking in and hearing all these cell phones ringing. That's life-shattering right there.
And there were, you know, a couple other notable individuals that I saw in the media. I mean, one was a mother who, you know, her son was at the club with his boyfriend, and they had learned that his boyfriend was killed, and she hadn't heard from him and didn't know what to think, and, you know, was just sending her prayers on air, I guess. And you know, the next day they identified his body as well, and unfortunately he had passed away. And there was another mother who was partying at the club with her son because, you know, she was just there to support her gay son and super proud to go out and dance with him. And she was shot dead, and her son survived, and she's a mother of 11 children. Like, you know, there's so many tragedies here, so many individual stories. And they're just starting to come out now that we know who the victims are, right? But
that's true. So what are your thoughts on the media responses? When I say that, I'm talking about, you know, for example, people like Jimmy Fallon or Trevor Noah, or I'm not sure if Ellen DeGeneres has responded yet, but I'm referring to, you know, the global media in terms of the big hotshots, you know, the celebrities and their responses. Do you think that it's enough, or do you think that, because at the end of the day, I think what needs to happen, in my opinion, is there needs to be a push for gun control and law changes and things like this to happen. Do you feel like America, because I mean, let's be honest, everybody outside of America, whether it be Canada, Australia, anywhere else, is responding with, you guys need to change your gun laws. But it all comes down to the Americans. So do you think enough is being done or said to provoke change within America?
I think the media response has been very interesting to watch, and it's morphed over, you know, the last few days since Sunday. I guess, so, I mean, first, my first reaction, you know, I learned of the news of Christina Grimmie, who I'm not sure if you heard that story, but she is a singer who was on The Voice last year, and she was shot at her own concert and killed.
Right, I heard about that.
On Friday night, I believe, the night before this shooting. And my first reaction when I read of this shooting on the same morning was that, because it was an LGBT crime, it was going to get overshadowed by the celebrity crime that had just occurred. And it's really sad that I thought that, but it's also really incredible that, and not to diminish, you know, what happened to Christina, because I feel like there hasn't been enough media attention on that, but you know, that this story has really taken over not only America and Canada, but the global audience as well. And there has been an incredible, like, to what I couldn't have even imagined, response of support from so many individuals. You saw it on the Tony Awards, you saw it on Jimmy Fallon, like you said, you saw it on every notable celebrity who has some media presence has been saying something about this and how tragic it is. And, I mean, Anderson Cooper's coverage has been incredible for the victims as well, and just sort of honoring them. And I just watched an interview with him yesterday, with the Attorney General of Florida, who has been an active campaigner against the gay community for so long, or the LGBT community. And, you know, she was basically spinning her tune to recognize the tragedy that had happened here as well. In terms of the difference it will make, you know, of course, yeah, America needs to get a handle on their gun issue. And I'm not sure if you saw Donald Trump's speech today.
Yeah.
But his response to this issue was that if the kids in the club had had guns holstered on their belts or on their ankles, the tragedy would have been much less severe because they would have killed the gunman.
Yeah,
drunk people in a nightclub in a dark environment who are rubbing up against each other dancing to have guns on them, like, that's a really great idea to preventing more gun deaths. I mean, and you have people rallying behind someone like this, which is incredibly scary. But the flip side of the coin is, sure, gun control might help a little bit, but if somebody really wants to go into a club and shoot up a bunch of people in a hate crime, they're gonna do it, right? And there's not a lot that can be done to stop them unless the police get there and neutralize that individual. And the scary part about that is that can happen here, that can happen in the UK, that can happen anywhere that, you know, members of the LGBT community are out just expressing themselves in what they feel is a safe environment. And that has affected me so much because I live in a country where I think I'm free to be who I am for most of the part. And now I'm terrified to even go out dancing again. Like, this could happen to me and it could happen to my friends.
It's insanity.
That's actually a crazy thought to have. But what I wanted to ask you too was, this is also being called an act of terror, and as well as a hate crime. And being an openly gay Muslim, what is your perspective? Because you wrote a really long status on Facebook that I thought was interesting, and I wanted to share. But just briefly, if you could tell us, like, you know, what your thoughts are and how this kind of affects you and other people out there who are in your position.
Yeah, I mean, when I heard about who the gunman was, I thought, was like, of course he has to be a Muslim. Of course there has to be more fuel for this Islamophobia that's going on in the States, right? Like, it couldn't have been anyone else. I mean, there was a white male individual who was intercepted going to shoot up or bomb the LA Pride Parade, and luckily, you know, that was stopped in its tracks. But nobody's talking about that because it's not the sexy thing to talk about on the news. It's not what Donald Trump is attacking everyone about. So, you know, there is a huge issue there, and it's, again, so, you know, intricate to dissect. But at the heart of it, you have this huge media response that this was an Islamist terror attack because this guy, you know, seemed to affiliate himself with some radical groups. But you know, when it comes down to it, this person had issues. Nobody goes into a club radicalized on their own unless they have some sort of mental health issues and some sort of, you know, hidden anger towards, you know, this community. And so now that the story is coming out that, you know, maybe he frequented this club a dozen times over the course of the year, and people recognized him from dating apps, like gay dating apps and things like that. The story has now shifted to, you know, one of internalized homophobia and rage, and maybe that came from, you know, his religious and cultural upbringing. But the fact is, you know, now instead of an Islamic terror attack, the story is sort of morphing.
This is Urban Definition.
Hey guys, this is Kareem here. Sorry about that. Due to some technical issues, we ended up having to go to the commercial break, and unfortunately weren't able to finish with our guest. However, we will hopefully have a chance to bring him back on a little bit later. But before we do that, we did want to segue into our topic of conversation with Sassan here, which is, well, I mean, my favorite portion, which is tech talk.
I kind of feel bad for like cutting him off and going straight to tech talk though.
Well, hopefully we can try to bring him back before the show ends. It was unfortunate there because we had to go to commercial, and I did everything I could to try and not have to, you know, try to close it up and hopefully have stop. But unfortunately, it is a really, what's the word I'm looking for here, Sass? It's a really engaging topic, and there's a lot to be said right now about everything that's going on.
That's very true.
So, I mean, unfortunately, it couldn't go down the way that we had hoped, but we would like to try and hopefully maybe bring him back a little bit later, which would be great.
Okay, then I'll try and keep it a little shorter than usual, so hopefully we can bring him back faster.
Hopefully, yeah.
But, okay, so as most of you know, yesterday was the start of E3, and it's still going on until tomorrow, and there's been a lot of big things happening. But the biggest one is honestly, how would I say this, the sexism, I guess? Because you guys have seen the Legend of Zelda trailer, right? No?
I saw it recently. Is that the, well, we're talking about the new one, right, that just came out?
Yeah, the one that's coming out on Wii U and hopefully for the NX next year, because they haven't put a release date.
That was the one that E3 released recently.
Yeah.
Okay, then yeah, I have seen it.
Yeah, for this one, they were expecting to put a female protagonist as well, so you can choose between male or female, depending on who you are.
Right, which I saw, which was, I was super stoked for, because it's going to be dope.
But they decided to cancel having a female protagonist, because, okay, this is the dumbest reason Nintendo has ever put up. They said that they couldn't put it into the plot, which I find really dumb, because they could have easily just put a female Link, or even better, let you play as Zelda and go and save Link. Why keep it to the old standards of just having a male saving a female princess? It's really dumb. It's like that Robert Munsch book. Do you guys remember it? I think it was called Paperback Princess.
The Paperback Princess, where the Paperback Princess ended up going to save the prince, and in the end, he was very snobby, and she was just like, well, forget you then.
Yeah, exactly. They could have just had something like that, and people would love it. It's Link already looks like a girl to begin with.
That's like, true.
Like, honestly, there's... I really don't understand why they need him.
But on the flip spectrum, in terms of, you know, where they do have a little bit of positivity, what's the name of the character? Shoots, like, not Metroid?
Metroid? Samus?
Samus.
Yeah, what about her?
She's a female.
That is true.
Seriously? And then he asks, he's like, what about her? I was like, you got it right there. It's a her.
No, but they should still, like, the reason I'm mad was because Zelda is a game for the whole family.
It is. It's definitely a cross-gender, no, it's a genderless, bounderless game. It's a fantastic game, and it's not driven by, it's not like Mario. Well, I mean, Mario is a whole other thing, but yeah. I mean, you could completely switch it to a female protagonist with, like, flawlessly.
Exactly, and the thing that bugs me even more is that this was supposed to be the year where, like, games are supposed to be suited for everyone. Pokemon is finally letting you choose your skin color.
Really?
That's
I didn't hear about that
thing.
One. Skin color. So first they transitioned over to you can choose your gender.
Yeah.
And now you can choose your skin color.
Yeah, which is huge, because even Animal Crossing did that last year, so...
Yeah.
Finally, before...
I would just like to say, You could do that in Little Big Planet from the get-go.
But you're a sack. You're made of cloth. No, but for Animal Crossing, the best part was before, if you did want to be a dark-skinned character, like before the change where you can choose it from now, you had to go to an island and tan yourself in order to get that tan look, which was really absurd. But now, I just love how you can just change it in Pokemon and whatnot. But speaking of Pokemon, they finally added four-player versus. So now instead of facing one-on-one, it's one versus three people, so you don't know who to battle.
Oh, that sounds like a lot of fun.
Yeah, so I'm really excited for that, even though I like brought Nintendo down with the whole female character thing.
Zayn was on his computer there, and he turned the back, and he wasn't looking at the mic, he goes, "What did you say?" "Yeah, that looks really cool."
I said, "That sounds really cool.
That sounds really cool.
You can do one versus three or whatever."
Yeah. I don't know. I really like that. But anyways, the biggest thing that I really liked from E3 was Hideo Kojima bringing back a horror game.
Oh, with, Walking Dead character, yeah?
Yeah, Norman Reedus.
There you go. Yeah! I'm so glad because if this game is going to make up for that Guillermo del Toro.
Yeah.
And because I was so stoked for that game. And then they're like, "Oh, no, we're not going to do it now." And I was like, no.
And the demo for PT, the game you're talking about, was the greatest demo ever. It gave me nightmares.
Yeah. And apparently, well, I think it was actually a guy we went to school with, Anthony Suen.
Yeah.
Who he's the one who I saw. He posted the video and he captioned at the top. He had written, "Get ready to have nightmares." And I was like, I watched it, and I was like, because I wanted to go in with, like, a clear mind. I was like, I watch it, and then I literally went, "Yes! Oh my gosh!"
For those of you who don't know why PT is so scary, it's because it's basically a movie.
Yeah.
It brings all that fear into a video game, because usually video games, to scare you, they just put jump scares. But no. This one makes you feel the atmosphere. It makes you go through hallways over and over and over again, making you feel like, I'm actually getting claustrophobic. I can't get out of here. What do I do? What's next? It's just terrifying.
I'm a big fan of, I don't know if you've ever played it, Fear.
Yeah.
So, for me, this seems more like a real version. For me, Fear was like the scariest game I'd ever played. And jeez. You ever played it?
No. But all this stuff is just making me scared.
But yeah, no. Fear was the first, and like that was the scariest game I'd ever played. And then to see this and to know that like there really is a next level scary. I am both excited and terrified simultaneously.
Should I watch this thing then, this demo?
PT? You should totally play it. Or you can watch PT.
No. I think he's talking about the Norman Reese game.
Oh,
no, PT.
Yeah, you should. PT. You should definitely play.
Do you? Are you a fan of like Guillermo del Toro movies?
Isn't he the guy that made Labyrinth or Pan's Labyrinth or something? Was that somebody else?
I think so. He also did Hellboy. I don't know if he did Pan's Labyrinth though. But I know. He
I
did.
Don't remember if I've seen.
He just. I think his
Hellboy.
Most recent movie has been Crimson Peak, which was. It was pretty dope. It was pretty dope. There was a little bit. There's a little bit too many jump scares for my liking, but it was still, like, the plot was dope.
Yeah, you don't need jump scares to scare people. Mm-hmm. There are other ways to scare you, and those ways stick in your head forever.
Mm-hmm. That's what makes all the classics so classic.
Oh my gosh. Okay, well, let's move on from PT. And I actually want to talk about the delivery of all the people at E3.
Okay.
Okay, so Nintendo, when they did their thing, it was just like a bunch of, honestly, I'm going to call them nobodies, because that's what it felt like. They were people who didn't know how to play the game, and they just, like, especially for the Zelda playthrough, this guy didn't smash pots, he didn't grab all the loot, he didn't know what he was doing, he had to keep going back and forth while this girl kept saying, "Hey, you missed this, hey, you missed that." It was terrible. But then if you watch Sony's playthrough, they had an orchestra playing over someone playing the demo, and it's as if this guy has played this demo over and over again so many times that he knew exactly when to turn, so the entire demo experience felt like a theatrical phenomenon. It was just amazing.
That's not a very like rare thing for Sony to do, though, because you watch, like, for example, when they were, even back when they were doing, I think it was Drake, the first Drake video game that came out.
Oh, I don't know what you're talking about.
Zayn, what was it called? Drake's Adventure. It's the one with basically the whole concept and the whole plot of the game is that he was like an Indiana Jones type character.
Okay.
And
Nathan Drake?
Was that the name? Is it Nathan Drake? Maybe.
I've heard that name as a video game character before. I just don't know.
I think number 4 just came out or something, and the game looks really awesome. But basically, it's not something that Sony doesn't do. It's very common for them to do this, where the videos that they do release with gameplay, action, and stuff like that is very theatrical, and it is very, like, on point, where it looks like, you know, you're not necessarily just watching a video game being played. You're watching, like, a cinematic experience.
I know what you're talking about, mm-hmm. but those kinds of things. But during this presentation, you actually saw the guy playing it, and he looked so serious.
Yeah.
And he didn't say a word. You just fell in love with the gameplay. I don't know.
That's good. Actually, going back to the Norman Reese game for a second.
Yeah.
The only thing I want to say about that was, if the gameplay mm-hmm. is as flawless as that video was, it is easily going to win Game of the Year.
Well, it's Hideo Kojima.
Yeah, I know.
Metal Gear. Come
yeah.
on.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Of course it's going to be like that. He's known for making movie-like video games.
And during the Walking Dead season, when a lot of people were saying that Norman's character, they're like, oh, they're going to kill him off because he has so much other things going on right now.
Yeah.
Dude, if you leave for this video game and video games series to come, I don't blame you. It's dope. It's good. I'm happy. I can be a happy man. I'm okay. You know, I do love my Walking Dead, but if you're going to leave to do something as spectacular as this, keep doing what you're doing, player.
Oh, my gosh.
I've never heard you say that in my life. I'm stuck on that right now.
Oh, goodness.
Oh, my gosh. Okay, let's wrap up E3 really quickly. The last thing I want to mention is that Mario Party is finally coming to the 3DS for the second time, but I'm hoping this time it's going to have internet play.
I want to know why Mario Party and Mario Kart are not apps yet.
That is so true, because everyone would play those.
Yeah.
And speaking of apps, Pokemon Go, I think I know why they didn't do Mario Party and whatnot. Pokemon Go, instead of fighting, it's a tap-based game.
Oh.
To beat the Pokemon, you tap really fast. I was like, that just killed it. Go away, Pokemon Go. I'm back to the originals. It's really dumb.
Yeah, what if you don't have the hand-eye coordination to do that, or the skills, or the speed.
I know.
You're going to lose every time.
You ain't never going to help anybody catch a Mewtwo. Exactly. Dundas Square, everybody's just
tapping off, on their phone. It's going to look so stupid. And I hope they change that.
And then I bet you it's going to be like an orchestra. All you're going to hear is everybody yelling, ah, my screen is cracked, my screen is cracked, my screen is cracked. Oh my God, our screens are cracked. Why is this happening?
I would love to see something like that, actually. That sounds like it'd be really fun from an outsider's perspective, because you know what they're doing looks crazy, and then it breaks their phone, you're like, this is on you. This is your fault.
Like, you just see a line of people outside of Dundas Square staring at, like, this, just staring into air, tapping their phones, and then all of a sudden they all just start yelling, oh my gosh, my phone!
And just not even knowing what's going on, you're just like, well, you've been tapping your phone for the last half hour. What's wrong with you?
All the tourists just walking by going, what are they doing? I don't know. It must be a Canadian thing.
Yeah,
it's going to be worldwide.
I could see that happening.
Oh my gosh, what's going on? It's a Brazilian thing.
Oh my gosh. Okay, speaking of phones, let's move out of E3. So the OnePlus 3 was finally, like, reviewed by people, and people finally had hands-on perspective, and it's going to be finally released for everyone. And it's not as great as people wanted it to be, but this is because all phones have basically hit their peak. They're all so good that we're just waiting for something crazy, like LG G5's widescreen camera, or the ability to change segments of the phone. But this new OnePlus 3... the specs are amazing. It has double the RAM of the Nexus 6P. It has 6 gigs of RAM. That's more than Zane's laptop over here.
Shots fired.
Which is a lot. Which is ridiculous. And people don't care. People don't care about this kind of stuff.
I think it's because of the generation that we currently live in. Everybody doesn't like... they have no patience. So it's all about speed, right? So it's just like, okay, well, I expect it to be that fast because that's how fast I need it to be anyways.
You're never gonna go above 2 gigs of RAM on a phone anyways.
Huh, you don't
Six
know me.
Gigs? No, that doesn't make any sense. No, what are you doing on your phone?
I know a guy.
I'm filming short films.
Using two cameras at once or something?
No, I'm totally.
It makes no sense.
Actually, you probably could at some point. They're just going to make your camera a phone.
Maybe. That'd be cool. Like having a DSLR phone so you can like swap lenses onto it. That'd be awesome. I would get that.
Isn't that what LG was trying to do?
I have no idea.
Yeah, with that Jason Bateman, Jason Statham commercial. Oh, watch me now. Watch me now.
That's not it. That's just having two cameras on the phone.
It looked like the camera came off and they were interchangeable.
Oh no, you were able to put more buttons. But that's about it.
Yeah, fair enough. Good tech talk, Sass.
Yeah.
We'll be back, guys, after this commercial break. I love saying that. It's so fun to say.
Urban definition. On CHHA 1610.
Welcome back, guys. I don't know, I was like my one line, I was like, welcome back, guys. I was like, deep reflection, so much going on. This has been a really heavy episode.
Yeah, it's been a very heavy day today, for sure.
Yeah. And I was so happy that we were able to get Dr., what was his last name again?
Dr. Hirji.
Hirji. A lot of what he was saying was fantastic. I'm sitting here, as he was talking, I'm sitting here going like, I'm clapping, I had to turn my mic off because I was so happy. He hit the nail on the head with a lot of what's going on right now.
He did, and so much that we forgot about the time, and it got cut off by a little bit by accident. Our apologies to him and to everyone listening. I did get a chance to call him during the commercial break and give my apologies. He said he's okay. No worries. You know, these things happen. Very cool with it, and definitely looking forward to having him back, hopefully in studio the next time. So thank you, Dr. Hirji, if you're listening. And to everyone at home, sorry about that. It's our fault.
I sitting here trying to like, I was trying to like find a way to keep him going, because I just wanted to keep here. Because he was a lot of what he was saying, I really liked, and I really, what's the word I'm looking for?
Connected
with. I agreed with a lot of what he was saying, and I was very interested in what he had to say. So I didn't want to lose him, and I was so sad when we lost him.
Definitely. It was my fault for asking such a heavy question at the end, too, knowing we only had a little bit of time left. But yeah, with that said, he's okay. And, you know, hopefully we'll have him on the show in the future.
Yeah, it would be an honor to have him in studio. It was already an honor to have him on a phone, muscleless in studio.
Definitely. And a very unique perspective at that. So moving on from that.
Before we talk about what's going on, you know, in terms of this weekend and kind of touching on the Inter-Rimi Festival and stuff like that, it just came to my attention that the CRTC just passed I don't know if it's really a law or just kind of coming down, but basically what they're looking to do is they're trying to lend, because over the last little while, we've lost a lot of our local programming, whether that's been multicultural programming or local coverage of certain things and stuff like that, and we've kind of shifted more towards global news. Do you guys agree or disagree?
No, I agree with that.
Sass?
Yeah, I agree.
Okay. So basically what the CRTC is doing is they're basically now saying that they're allocating 7 hours a week of local news. So basically all the...
Local TV news.
So basically, it doesn't matter, all of them, everybody now is going to have to produce... basically 7 hours weekly of local news, which I'm kind of glad to hear. I'm happy to see that. It's a baby step. It's not a heck of a lot more than what's already on air.
Well, for not a heck of a lot, it's $90 million.
Well, yeah, that too.
So, I mean, it's... But to be fair, yeah, you're right. It's not, like, insanely... An insane amount of money.
It ain't insane in a membrane, but it's the right step in the right direction.
And I'm glad they're trying to preserve culture and keep things like this alive. So that's definitely a good step.
Well, they caught a lot of heat when they started cutting things left, right, and center. So it was only a matter of time before they had to bring something back. Come on.
Well, there's a lot of changes, right? There's definitely going to be changes. And it's going to happen. We'll see how this works out.
That's true. We'll see how it works out indeed. So what's going on this weekend, guys?
Inter-Rimi's happening this weekend.
Inter-Rimi. Or if you guys have heard the commercials during our commercial breaks with a lot of bass, it's Inter-Rimi. Or something like that.
They're really fun to listen to.
Yeah, it is really dope. So just a quick summary. Basically, I'll give you guys lowdown, even though you guys are going to be there. The Inter-Rami Festival is essentially a celebration of the summer solstice. This year, while we've done it a few times, this year is going to be a little bit different because this year we're doing it in solidarity with the victims of the Ecuadorian earthquake. It's going to take place on June 18th and June 19th, which is Saturday and Sunday this weekend. So with it being Father's Day, bring the whole family down. It'll be great. Basically, the way it's going to work, Saturday, we have programming, whether that be children's face painting, activities. I know they're trying to do relay. There's a lot of stuff going on. All that starts from 1 p.m. till 10 p.m. on Saturday, and then Sunday, 1 p.m. again till 9 p.m. It's going to take place at Christie Pitts Park, which is going to be, well, it's the intersection of Bloor Street and Christie Street. And there's going to be a lot of Latin American food, a lot of local artists. And essentially, I mean, the whole theme is it's a walk for peace. Proceeds are going to go towards the victims of the Ecuadorian earthquake. So it's a great cause. There's going to be a lot of great activities, a lot of great programming, performances. So the weather, which I just heard is supposed to be like 30 degrees on both days. So wow. It's a great opportunity to get out of the house, get into, you know, an amazing park and kind of have a great time. You know what I mean, guys?
I hope there's frozen treats. 30 degrees.
Yeah. I hope there's frozen treats, too.
You going to have some ice cream trucks or a snow cone or anything?
Oh, I hope there's going to be snow cones. I believe there is an ice cream truck, which I think there was last year as well. And I think he's coming. And this guy, like, I'm talking, like, if you guys have ever been to Christie Pitts Park, this man is actually legit rolling his truck down the hill for where the vendors are going to be. So you can get ice cream in the shady places and the sunny places. Y'all are good. I got you. We got y'all covered.
The dedication, man. Wow, yeah. But get into that sun, get into summer mode and go down to Christie Pitts this weekend.
Yeah, it should
definitely
be good.
Check out Inter-Rami. Kareem, you're going to be there for sure, right?
I will be there all weekend. I'm actually going to, I'm there from Friday getting ready for the event. Sunday, I'm there from like 7 a.m. till, well, 10 p.m. So if you want to come out, come check me. Sunday, I'll be there again all day. You guys are going to be there on a Sunday, right?
I'm going to be there on Sunday for sure.
UD is going to be, I guess, live broadcasting from Christie Pitts Park on Sunday from 8 p.m. to 9 p.m. So tune in to CHHA from 8 p.m. to 9 p.m. on Sunday to hear these guys' beautiful voices.
Definitely. Thank you for listening.
And, well, hopefully you can actually just come live and see everybody because it should be dope.
Yeah, definitely. And it's a celebration. It's a good for the community. I think it's something definitely worth checking out. And, you know, if you've always wanted to see kind of what Latin American culture is, this is a good way to look at it, you know?
Father's Day gets very tricky because you always have to look for new and different things to kind of do, and you don't always want to have to go through the same grind. So this is an opportunity to try something new, come out, experience culture, because at the end of the day, that's what makes things so amazing is the cultural aspects.
And I think that's something we touched upon at the beginning of our show as well, is that, you know, with everything is, at the end of the day, it's culture that really, you know, binds us as humans together, and it really makes our interactions daily that much more fun and exciting to learn different things. So I'm, you know, definitely come out to this event, check it out, meet Kareem and I and Sassan, and have fun.
For sure. And on the less cultural side of things, the Much Music Video Awards are going to be going on this weekend, which should be interesting. I know there's a plethora of celebrities coming down.
As there always is. And it's free to view on Queen Street. Unless you have a wristband, you can go inside towards the gate, towards the stage, and see these celebrities up close and personal.
Sounds great.
Should be dope. Should be good.
Sassan's going to be there.
I'm totally going to be there. I want to go to all these things.
Sassan is like that one magical person who's just everywhere.
Pretty sure he has a twin.
I still love the fact that, like, I texted him that one weekend being like, what are you up to this weekend? He's just like, I'm in Montreal. Why are you in Montreal? I needed to practice my French.
Wait, that's why you went?
Yeah.
Just to practice French.
Yeah.
Well, good on you, man. That's good. Talk about, you know, really getting to know culture. I have never met anyone who just does that, so good job.
I also went to see my friend's show, and I told her I would see it like one time that month, so.
one time that month.
Because she was performing every weekend?
Oh, for 1 month.
But then that weekend, you were like, hey, you need to know French for an interview we're doing at the end of the month.
Mm-hmm.
So I was like, okay, going to Montreal.
That's true.
I gotta say, so you're Sassan, you're a good friend. I've made a lot of promises I do not keep.
Oh, no. That's terrible.
So I just don't make promises anymore.
Sassan usually follows on his promises. On his promises.
On his provinces.
Provinces.
Yeah.
But he has a really hilarious knack for always doing it just a little bit after the deadline.
Anyone who knows Sassan can attest to that.
Oh, my God.
So, guys, as I say every week, if you guys are going out, please remember to be safe. Do not drink and drive, because ain't nobody need to deal with that foolishness. Have a fantastic week, a magnificent weekend, and we love y'all. Peace.
Have a good night.
Bye.
CHHA.